I don't need.
What? What did you say?
Which deck should I, are you gonna
okay,
use?
What, which kind of faction would you like? Do you like the Ninja Assassins? Do you like the KGB, the British Agency?
I'm gonna take the Crypt.
The Crypt, that's the KGB kind of guys. The generic, they're pretty much all around good. Okay, I'm going to get... let's take the Shadow Patriots. Okay, now as always, did you load the deck? Okay, as always, Control Shift S to set up your game.
Game set up.
Oh, sorry, forgot to load the mission deck. Spycraft mission deck. Okay, now we can go. And you, Control Shift S.
Load a mission deck as well.
No, you don't have to load it. Only one of us has to load it. Okay, so the game is set up. You have your three leaders in ascending order of cost on your left. You have the five missions in the queue, and you can see the two of them, and you see your ability on the side. Okay, so should I start explaining the type of cards there are?
Sorry?
Should I explain the type of cards that are in the game?
Oh yeah, well, okay, we'll start with this one in the middle.
Okay, so the ones in the middle are mission cards. They are basically what you use to gain victory points, the same way like Call of Cthulhu. The number on the right is the victory points, how much money you get, how much points you get if you win this mission. Okay?
Okay.
Okay. The number on the left is the cover, how much this bonus helps in... combat missions. So when somebody is trying to shoot you or generally do some damage to you, they need to beat this number at least. So if your agent doesn't have a lot of combat, this helps you a bit to avoid damage. Then below that you have
the number on the left.
Yeah, the little two. Then the number on the bottom, the traits, what you use, various cards use to trigger. So intrigue tells you what kind of mission it is, so this trait is important. It tells you what kind of actions you can do in this mission. Private is not so important, and charisma plus two is showing how much more charisma you need to have in this mission to win it as an attacker. And then you have an ability for the attacker and an ability for the defender. In this case, it's the same for both. I'm talking about the sting, yeah? And it says that when this mission is over, only one agent will remain to figure out if you win it or not. So it's good if you have one agent with a lot of charisma and the others don't. And this way you can figure out which agents to send on the mission or not. Hold on a second, let me fix my music, a bit too loud. Okay, so the other mission has a completely different ability.
Why are the other three missions face down?
Yeah, so the other three missions, you don't know what they are, and you will always see them either when one of the two missions in front goes away, or when you use intel on it, when you use intel to see what it is. Now, agent cards. Agent cards is the one that you have in front of you. That's a leader as well. You can see it with a little leader watermark on the bottom. But agents are exactly the same. They have the same kind of abilities. Leaders have on the, and the agents on the top right have an expense cost. The expense cost is basically how many other gadgets or agents for the case of leaders you can use without paying extra. So with both, you start with a 4 and I start with a 3. So you can put more expensive stuff on your agent than I can. Now let me show you what you can put. You can put, for example, a machine gun, or for example, mobile artillery. You can see on the top right of these cards, they also have an expense cost. You see it?
Yep. Five.
So you see both of these are more expensive than my agent. So if they were lower than my agent, I could just attach them like this and I wouldn't have to do anything else, because if they were lower or equal, because my agent has enough.
Where's the 8 coming from?
Where's the what?
Where's the 8 coming from? Your character's only 3, yeah?
Yeah, 3. So, if I wanted to attach an Ingram, which is a cost 5, normally I wouldn't. If it was below, if it was 3 or less, I would just attach it normally, without any extra cost. If it's above, then I need to pay bravado. Bravado is you discard a card from your hand, any card from your hand that you want, and you add the card's bottom right cost, bottom right number, to the cost, or to your skill. So, for example, if I wanted to play the Ingram, I could discard from my hand the mobile artillery, which has a 2 bravado on the bottom right, and that would be 3 expense for me, plus 2 from the discarded bravado, 5. So that's enough to equip the Ingram. With me so far?
Okay, so to recap, you have a certain amount of skill or whatever in the top
expense, yes,
corner. The item that you want to use also has a cost in the top right.
Exactly.
Top right-hand corner. If you are not less than that number, so in this case, if it isn't 1 to 3,
yep,
you can then discard a card,
yep,
number in the bottom left corner to your main character's thing.
Yep. And that's how bravado works.
Hit 5.
Bravado works exactly the same way for everything. When you're trying to use an ability, for example, and you don't have enough skill, you can also use bravado. When you're trying to use a combat ability, like a mission ability, and you don't have enough skill, you can use bravado. You can only use one bravado each time, so higher bravado cards are usually much more valuable for this reason. But this is generally the easiest way to use the cards that are too expensive for you. Now, an agent has various skills on the left. So you see, on the top to bottom, it's charisma. What's this? Charisma, combat, transport, and craft. You see them. You have different ones on your.
What was the last one again?
Craft. It's craft. Just generic guile, let's say. Okay. Now, these skills by themselves don't do anything except in missions. So this charisma and this combat and everything, they're not really useful by themselves. But you can use them. I will explain later how you use them in missions. And then you have your character that has some abilities. In this case, you see, first of all, the traits. So this is the Shadow Patriots. Shadow Patriots is my faction. And a Faceman is a trait of the agent. In this case, it's a kind of agent that can mimic other agents. But the trait usually is only triggered by special abilities. Some cards say Faceman only and stuff like that. So you know that you can only use certain cards with this guy. And last one is the ability, React Charisma. And then it tells you that if somebody, in my case, if somebody redirects my actions, I can redirect it again. In your case, you can discard missions from the mission queue. Your character, for example, has very little charisma, a lot of transport, and decent craft and combat. And he's a wheelman. Wheelman is the kind of guy that basically drives vehicles.
Just to slow down a little bit. So there's three basic types of cards. You've got agents, actions, gear.
Agents, boost, agents, actions, gear, and missions. Missions is in the center.
Gear and what?
Agents, actions, gear, and missions.
Oh, missions, right.
And in the subtype of agent is the leader, which only have four.
Okay, so I know how to...
You know how...
A gear, because you showed me that example. How would you cast a character?
Okay, so...
Same way?
Let me explain now. When you play a gear, or either a gear or... Hold on a second. My thing is a bit messed up. Okay. So when you want to play a gear or a character, you play it face down always. So there's a lot of bluffing going on. So if I play the gear from at the moment, if I wanted to play a gear at my character, I would target my character, double click the gear, and it would go like this. You wouldn't see what it is. I could easily play an action as a gear. I would play an action card, and if you right click on a card on your hand, you can see it as plays as a face down gear or plays as a face down agent. So if you play an action card as a gear or an agent as a gear, the opponent doesn't know that you haven't actually played an agent or a gear. So let's say I play this card as an agent. Yeah, I play it down. You don't know what it is. You see only that I've recruited an agent. If later on I want to reveal it, let's say I have these two. Yeah? So I have these two face down agents. And that's how you play them from your hand. Now, to make them active, these are the moment they are inactive. To make them active as an agent, you have to pay as much expense from your leader as they have on the top right. So let's bring this agent up. So links, yeah? So she has only two cost. She's less...
Okay, so it's sort of like Netrunner. It's sort of like Netrunner. You play the res cost when they're flipped over, not when you place them on the top.
Exactly. And you can flip them over at any time. You can even flip them over as a react to another player's action.
Okay.
So anytime a player says, I'm going to do this action, they announce which action they're going to do, you can flip over as many cards as you want. So this is very useful, for example, when somebody says, okay, I'm going to do combat to your agent, and he sees that your combat is one, so the difficulty to get combat done on you is one, and you say, okay, I flip over my Ingram, so now I have plus two combat, so your action will fail. So you can do something like this. You can surprise the opponent with gear or agents. With me by now?
I believe so.
Okay.
Yeah, you can bluff your opponents. You don't have to, like, that face down card is presenting as an agent, but
yep,
it could be something completely different.
Exactly.
Just as a bluff.
Yeah, and I could easily do this, for example. I could play this card like this, and you don't know if it's a gear or not. So let's say it isn't a gear, and I have to flip it up. I do it, and it should have discarded it. Yeah, so it tells you that the card is discarded. So when you flip it over, the game will tell you, okay, that was not an illegal card for this card, you're going to discard it. So anytime you play an illegal card on the table and you have to reveal it, the game will automatically discard it if it is not a valid card. Okay?
Okie dokie. I think I've got all this.
Okay.
And
now,
and the payment thing is what you already talked about. So this guy, this Lynx guy,
yeah,
you could reveal him because he costs under three.
Yeah, three or less.
But if he costs more than three, you could discard
Bravado.
The extra cost.
Yeah. Now, not all leaders have this cost. So my leader has three, your leader has four. If you see the leaders on your left, the three face down cards on your left next to your faction, they have increasingly better stats and increasingly better expense. So these guys can quickly get more stuff in. They can get better equipment and better agents. And these guys come in either when your current leader dies, when the leader leaves the game, or when you debrief them. Okay, now I'm going to explain a bit how actions work. The game has two phases. It has the intel phase and the combat phase. The intel phase is like the preparation for the combat. During the intel, we exchange actions. So you go and I go and you go and I go. Starting with the player who has the most craft. So at the moment, you would go first because you have more craft on the table. Yeah? So I have only two, you have three. Now, as an action, during your turn, you can do any of the following things. Let me see, do I have any... anything? If you go, let me see, game document. Yeah, if you go on the octagon, go where it says game documents, and then where it says reference sheet. Did you find it?
Sorry, say that again.
Go where it says game documents on the top. Game documents and then the reference sheet.
Okay.
That will open a reference sheet page, and then you can see what you can do in the intel phase. So, the things you can do is pass, where you can say, I don't want to do anything at this moment. If both player passes consecutively, the turn ends. So, you can try to bluff and wait to see what your opponent does with a pass, but if they pass as well, then you lose the rest of your turn. Brief a leader. So how do you brief a leader? Briefing, you select one of your leaders or as many leaders as you want in your from your face down leaders, and you use a brief action from your agent. You cannot do this the first turn your agent hits the table. So when you see this little fish icon on your leader, this little fresh leader, then you cannot debrief. But when you debrief, you basically target one of your leaders and then use the brief action on your card, on your leader, on your existing leader. Let me see where it is. Brief target leader. So you will get a little icon that you briefed somebody and a little brief icon on your leader, on the face down leader. If you get as many brief tokens on your face down leader as their expense, then you can flip them up. So you basically debrief those leaders.
Many as the top left number.
Yeah. So slowly your current leader can bring more powerful leaders in. Currently the game, the leaders that you have been set up so that your current leader can bring in a new leader in two turns of briefing. The cheapest leader. And then that cheapest leader can bring somebody new with two turns. And then somebody new in two turns. So it's always two turns to debrief a new leader. And your leaders are generally better agents than your normal agents. They have generally better stats and better abilities. And you use these to hire better agents. So if you have very expensive agents in your deck, you need to hire more expensive leaders. Okay. Reference it. Next thing you can do, you can discard the first mission in the queue if it was there at the start of the turn. So every one of us can say, okay, I don't like the first mission in the queue, I'm going to discard it. But only one of us basically has a chance to do this. This is to allow, basically, if none of us wants to take any missions, to progress the queue a bit more. Whenever a mission in the queue is removed, then another one takes its place at the back. So they all slide in towards the right or left in your case, and then you see the next mission, so the third mission will reveal, and then the fifth mission will go on the back. With me so far?
Yes.
Okay.
It slides along, the next one's revealed, and then a new card's dealt face down at the end.
Yeah. Okay. Now, recruit an agent and requisition a gear. I explained already how you work. You pay them, put them face down on the table, and then you can raise them, let's say, at any time you want. Snoop.
Yep.
You allows your an agent of yours to take an intel action, craft 4, to look at any face down card. Now, this is the meat and the meat of the game. When you say any action, says always a skill. It says charisma 5, charisma 2, or craft without a number, or craft 4, like Snoop. Now, this target number is the skill that one of your agents needs to have to be able to take this action. So if I wanted to play to Snoop at a face down card, I would need a craft 4. And my agent has only 2. So I would have to discard 2 bravado. Your agent has 3, so you would have to discard 1 bravado. If you manage to reach craft 4, either by yourself or with items, then you don't need to discard anything. You can just snoop one card on the table. And you can only do this once per agent. With me so far?
Okay, so if you can accumulate 4 crafts,
yeah,
each agent can peek at 1 card, and if that card is not a legal card, it's discarded.
Exactly. Right? Otherwise, you just see what it is and you know what's coming. But when you use the snoop, yeah, only the agent that used the snoop looks at the card. So when you snoop, not every agent looks a card. You look 1 card for that agent that used the snoop. So if you have 3 agents on the table, one of them snoops, you see 1. Then you have to do another craft 4 with a different agent to see another card. So if all your agents have very low craft, then you need to discard the bravado each time. And of course, each of these takes an action.
Okay.
So you do a snoop, then the other player plays. Then you do a snoop, then the other player plays. It's all of these are your action for the current sequence. You can use an intel action on a card any number of times per turn. So if you say this game has the ability that you the cards you can use multiple times per turn, but each card you can only use once per ability per turn. That's a bit not sure I like this design, but it's the way it is. So basically, if you have a card that has an ability, let's say...
Just say that again. I missed you. You're breaking up a little bit. Just say that again.
I say, whenever you have a card that has an intel action, you can use that card once per turn. So when you use that card, it will get a little token that will say you cannot use it again this turn. So let's say you have a card that says... Intel 4, craft 4, heal an agent. Yeah? Remove a wound from an agent. You can do the same thing like Snoop.
Hang on for a sec. I just gotta... Sorry, I just had to close the door to the balcony so I could hear you. Better.
Okay, so
my character has an intel transport. And
exactly.
I can use that once per turn.
Once per turn. So let's see that you want to use it. Let's say right click on your character and use text ability.
Yep.
Right click on your character and use text ability.
Use text ability.
Yeah. So that will put the little marker there, and now if you try to use the text ability again, it will tell you, okay, you've used it once. Do you want to bypass or just wait next turn? Yeah. So if you want to use a text ability on an agent, you can just use that or just double click on them. That's the default what they do. Yeah. If you double click on an agent, they try to use the text ability. Okay.
Okay.
So, the other thing you can do is You can use any card from your hand. If you have an Intel action card from your hand, you can play it and use it at that moment. Usually they require an agent, and they say this agent needs to do an Intel craft or an Intel combat or an Intel whatever. So to do use those cards, you just double click on them and they will go on the table and it will announce to the opponent what you're doing. So if I play this card, you will see it on the table and you say, I'm going to attempt to play Demolition Derby. And this requires, for example, what is it? Mission Transfer 7. So this is a mission card, but let's say it's an Intel. And then I would have to discard four Bravado to be able to use it because my agent only has three transport. Four Bravado cards are very rare. Okay. And finally, the two last things. Run a solo op. We're not going to use solo ops for now, so just ignore solo op cards. And run a mission. Now, mission is where the combat of the or the conflict of the game happens. Anytime during the Intel phase, you can announce that you're running a mission card. You select that you target the card that you want, and you select run target mission. Like this. Okay, so you will see that I'm running this mission. With me so far? You, are you here?
Hang on. Sorry, there's like trucks and stuff going all over the place. Okay, so like Star Wars, you select which of your characters is going to...
Okay, so let's take it slowly, yeah? First, you select which mission you're going to run. Now you are the attacker and the opponent is a defender. Now you select which agents you're going to send on the mission. Let's say that you have this agent and then you have this agent. You can send face-down agents and face-up agents. But you can set the maximum of five. Now... you double click on them to select them as getting taking part in the mission. So I'm going to send here and here. Now you want to select somebody as a defender. So select your character, double click on him. Okay. You don't have to move them anywhere, just stick them where they are. Okay. Now, we are in the mission. The mission works as follows. Whoever has the most craft in the mission gets to go first. So in this case we have equal craft because you have three and I have three as well. So
all right, so it's three total, not per character.
It's per mission. So in this mission we both have two agents. I have two agents with a total of three craft, and you have one agent with three craft. So our totals are the same.
Gotcha.
So we have to calculate I think in that case the attacker goes first, but I'm not sure, I have to look it up a bit. But anyway, one of us goes first. And again, we start alternating actions. Now, each mission has a different action you can alternate. You have intrigue missions, in which case you use your charisma, and your charisma can bluff opposing agents. Now, how do you use the charisma? You need to use charisma more than the charisma of the opponent. The charisma of the opponent is the target number. And if you do it, then the opponent is bluffed. And do I have it here? Yeah, it's baffled, sorry. So when an opponent is baffled, all their skills become zero and they are exposed. Expose, I will explain what it does in a second. So if you want, right click on your clean sweep and put a baffle icon on him.
Put a bluff icon on it.
Baffle. Put a baffle. Right click on the clean sweep.
Baffle.
And then you will see there baffle clear in the middle. Yeah. So We know now that clean sweep is buffed. When he's buffed, all his skills are zero. So you can still use him in the mission, but everything you do will require a bravado card, pretty much. So if I wanted to buffle him, for example, with Lynx, who has only 2 charisma, actually I could do it because he has 0. So clean sweep is very easy to buffle, yeah, because he has 0 charisma. Okay, these are the intrigue cards. You have the chase missions, for example, the high speed melee. A chase mission uses transport instead. When you use chase action successfully on another agent, and you compare transport in this case, if you succeed, the other agent is sent home out of the mission. So you would right click on them and say, leave mission. Or leave.
That's if you win transport.
If you win the transport on that lead, for some reason that doesn't work, I have to fix it. Okay, let me just note this down to fix it. Okay, so let's say you would drive them away from the mission. So that's with chase missions. In chase missions, you compare transport, and whoever has the most wins, sends the other back. If you have most as an attacker, you send the other back. And then you have the actions. For example, if I did something and then you had an action, you had the clean sweep 3, you could use the transport to send one of my agents back. We have 2 other kinds of missions. We have, let me show you some from the game. We have combat missions. They're called fight. And we also have intrigue, chase, intrigue. We have, is there one more? Oh, no. So that's all. Intrigue, chase, and fight.
That's all. Intrigue, chase, and...
So we have 3 types of missions, sorry. So, fight missions use combat. And if you manage to have more, if you use an action and the target number of an opposing agent is their combat or the cover of the mission, whatever is highest. If you manage to reach this target number, then you give the opposing agent a wound. When you wound somebody, they are turned sideways, and they have -2 in all skills. So they're less effective. If you wound somebody who's already wounded, they get discarded. They die. If you kill an opposing agent, an opposing leader, then their next leader immediately comes into play. So killing an opposing leader might be not very good, depending on the state of the game. If you kill the final leader, the most expensive leader, you win the game. With me so far?
Yes, characters have 2 wounds. If you kill a leader in play, the next one comes into play without you paying, without the other
exactly
paying the cost.
Exactly. And if you
kill them, if you, unless you got a I think I'm pretty much with you. I mean, it'll make more sense once we start doing an actual turn.
Yeah.
Can you just repeat the stuff about the briefing?
Briefing.
My card. Like if I had this guy out here, right?
Yeah.
This card, and it's not attached to a story. Is that called the HQ?
What did you say?
Quarters. Is that called the what is the headquarters? Like a lot of these things saying.
Yeah, headquarters is where your agents are when they're not in a mission.
Headquarters. What does that mean?
Headquarters when your agents are when they're not in a mission.
That's what I thought. Okay, so, and during the debriefing phase, you just click on whichever guy you want to load up.
Yeah, and not
and
during
then,
the
then you
not.
Click on each of your
No. You only your leaders can debrief, can brief your other leaders. Debrief phase is a completely different thing. Debrief phase is where you refill your hand. But what you're doing, what you want to do is briefing. Briefing one of your leaders. So to do that, you just right-click, select one of your leaders, and then right-click your active leader. Only your active leader can brief, and then use brief target leader. So do it now. It will warn you that you're still fresh, but you can bypass it, and you will see what happens.
Leave mission, clear abilities, brief target leader.
Yeah.
Only active leaders may perform a brief action. Proceed anyway.
Yeah. Oh, now you briefed with your agent.
Oh, now you briefed.
Your agents are not allowed to brief. Only your leader, your active leader, is allowed to brief.
Oh, right. That's this guy here.
Exactly. So you need to.
Okay, and he.
You need to target the target leader, not yourself, and then use the brief.
So I do that.
Yeah, and then right click and brief target leader. Did you use the other girl again? Because I see 7.
No, I just.
No. Don't right click the face down leader, right click the active leader. So you target the inactive leader and you brief with the active leader. And you can only do this once per turn, and only if the agent, the leader, didn't come into play this turn. So you cannot do it the first turn. Okay. And now let me explain how you win missions, and we can start the game. Now, you see missions have a little thing on the left where it says charisma plus 2, transport plus 4, combat plus 5, etc. Yeah?
Just say that again.
Each mission that you see has they say chase, public, and then transport plus 4, or private, combat plus 5, or charisma plus 2, etc.
Yeah, okay, I'm looking at the direct approach.
Okay, so you see the direct approach has fight, which tells you what kind of actions you can do. You can use fight actions, combat actions. Public, it doesn't matter for now, and combat plus 5. Now, combat plus 5 is what you need to win this mission. And what this means is that the combat, the combined total of the combat of all your agents in the mission has to be higher by 5 than the combined combat of the opposing agents in the mission.
You need to beat the opponent by 5 points.
Exactly. So how do you do that? You either kill all the agents, because it's a combat mission, it's a fight mission, or you wound them enough not to be a problem, or you just come in with overwhelming force. So if you manage, if as an attacker you manage to have 5 combat more than the opponent, you score the mission, and this mission goes into your score pile, and you have 7 victory points. If you do not win the mission, and you don't manage to gather the enough combat, then the defender automatically wins the mission, even if they have less combat than you. So, if the attacker doesn't win the mission, the defender does. So, in this case, you have to be certain that you can win each mission that you go, because otherwise your opponent is just going to score it.
Okay.
And I think that's about it. Let me just cancel this mission. Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, and you win the game when you have 20 victory points. One last thing that I didn't mention is that I told you how combat works. Eh? You start the combat.
Okay, let's give it a try.
Yeah, you start the combat. Whoever has the most craft goes first. And in the combat, you again alternate actions, mission actions this time. A mission action can be either the default mission action, which is intrigue or chase or whatever, or it can be one of the cards in your hand or in the table. So if you have, like, example, this Uzi has a combat action on itself. And the trick about combat actions is that you can use them even if it's not a fight mission or even if it's not an intrigue mission. As long as the mission says, as long as the card says, mission combat X or mission in chase X or mission intrigue X or whatever, and it doesn't say only for a fight mission, you can use it. In this case, for example, the Ingram says use this fight only on a combat mission, on a fight mission. So you cannot use it outside of a fight mission. But there are other cards, for example, this one, which says give a target engine -2 to all skills. And it doesn't say fight mission only. So I can use this card even on an intrigue mission. So we go chatting and I bash you with a brass knuckle. Okay.
Yep.
Okay, and that's about it. Okay. Ah, yeah. Start of turn, end of turn. You start the turn. Let me just quickly see here how the turn goes. Okay. Interface is the first. No, interface is not the first. Game setup. Blah 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 blah. Yeah. Okay. So the last action, the last thing we do when we both passed. Ah, sorry, I forgot to mention one more thing. Only one of us can run a mission each turn. If you run a mission, then the other player cannot run a mission this turn. So it makes sense. If you run the mission fast enough, then the other player won't have a chance to run a mission. If you, however, rush a mission, you may go unprepared. So make sure that you balance these two out. So going too fast or not going at all. And you have, I think you start with 7 cards in your hand, or 6 cards in your hand, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, you start with 6 cards in your hand. Or 7 cards, I don't remember. Yeah, okay. And in the debriefing phase, you draw 5 cards, and then you have to discard down to 7. So your hand refills very, very fast, generally. So you have, it's a bit like Star Wars, that you use your edge cards in combat and then you refill your hand. It's pretty much the same here. You use your cards for bravado and then at the end of the turn, they refill back to 7. Almost, yeah. If you have less than 5, less than 2, then you will refill as much as possible. With me so far?
This game looks really cool. Okay, sweet.
All right.
I'm
so,
pretty sure. Yep, I gotcha.
Let's
your hand refill. You draw 5 cards at the beginning of your turn.
Mm-hmm. No, you draw 5 cards so at the end of the turn.
You really need to draw 5 cards and you discard to 7.
Exactly.
So you can be pretty. You can be pretty ruthless with your bravado.
Exactly.
Payments.
Exactly. Well, you have to balance playing stuff, playing agents, and playing bravado.
That's the way it hand resourcing.
Yeah.
And I imagine because of the way the missions work, most of the game is going to be in setting up your table or all buffing and stuff.
Yeah.
Down cards and then doing bicks rather than
yeah.
turns are just going to be putting cards on the table.
Yeah.